1960 at Squaw Valley. Women's speed skating and the biathlon became Olympic fixtures here, and the dramatics were provided by the United States ice hockey team, who won the gold medal against all odds.
Jack Whitaker, who's providing us with those old moments from past Olympics, will be all over Calgary for the next 16 days, picking up stories and, I think, some of his incomparable essays. Now, here comes the Oslo flag. This is an Olympic tradition now, started in Oslo in 1952. The Sarajevo delegation will be coming in, the last city to have played host to the Winter Olympics, and their mayor, who is called President Slavko Selimovic, will pass the flag first to Juan Antonio Samaran, and he will pass it over to the mayor of Calgary, who was elected the last time with 93% of the vote.
Well, that's because he used to be a television reporter.
Well, of course. Still hangs out in the bar of the St. Louis Hotel sometimes to talk to the guys.
That's right. Incredible. I never saw him here so popular.
De nombreuses villes à travers le monde ont eu l'honneur d'abriter la flamme olympique. No city, no country has shone brighter than Sarajevo, Yugoslavia, home for the 14th Olympic Winter Games. Bearing the flag presented to the International Olympic Committee by Oslo, the host city of the 1952 Winter Games, is the mayor of Sarajevo, President Selimovic. The Oslo flag will be presented to His Worship Ralph Klein, the mayor of Calgary, to hang in the City Hall for the duration of the 15th Olympic Winter Games. Le drapeau d'Oslo sera confié au maire de Calgary pour la durée des Jeux.
Uniforms for the opening ceremony 4 years ago. They're the same ones.
These are the sons and daughters of Yugoslav immigrants to Canada.
The flag has been passed. Another part of the opening ceremony is complete. Mayor Klein with the flag for Calgary.
Some people think that women don't know anything about cars, but some of us know as much as men, like the difference between a T-Bird and a Topaz. The T-Bird has a V6 fuel-injected engine, and the Topaz has front-wheel drive and McPherson struts. Let's see what the guys know.
The T-Bird has two doors.
The Topaz has four doors.
The T-Bird is $39.90 a day at Hertz.
The Topaz is $37.90.
I rest my case.
Do you think they'll renew our contracts?
Place is Calgary, home of the 1988 Winter Olympics, where a lifetime of work will be measured in seconds. But if you go, bring your camera and your Visa card, because the Olympics don't take place all the time, and this time, the Olympics don't take American Express. Visa, it's everywhere you want to be.
And in the goal for the United States, Bud Light Zone, Spuds McKenzie.
Denying Spud celebrates with Bud Light. He knows everything else is just the light.
This Bud Light is out of sight, my little Spudski.
Afin de porter la flamme olympique. Toutes les générations
et les représentants
depuis Barbara Ann Scott.
These are native Canadians here who will provide the music.
Les espoirs olympiques
de brought to light the flame that will burn during the Olympic Games, representing all the tribes.
The Indians in this part of the world go back 11,000 years, Jim, and here you have representations of all the tribes, the Pagan, the Blood, the Blackfoot, by the way, so named for their moccasins, not for their feet, the Beaver, the Plains, the Woodland Cree, the Slevy, the Chippewa.
Stadium now.
Here it comes.
Sacred Olympic flame.
Now carrying it in jointly, a man and a woman, Ken Reed and Kathy Priestner. Kathy won a silver medal in 500-meter speed skating in Innsbruck in 76. She's married, has two children, lives in Calgary. Ken Reed, one of the original Peter Crazy Canucks. He was the first North American to win a men's downhill World Cup race, subsequently won five of them. He also lives in Calgary and is involved in, of all things, broadcasting.
Ken Reed a fait partie de l'équipe canadienne de ski de 1973 à 1980. En 1978, il était nommé l'athlète par excellence.
Moving out from one of the tunnels right now is a man named Rick Hansen in a wheelchair, the man in motion. He started from British Columbia in a wheelchair, worked his way across 34 countries and four continents around the world under his own hand power to raise funds for spinal cord research. He raised $21 million, and in a moment, he's going to touch the flag right there.
We've had him on the news, Jim. I know you've had him on the Wide World of Sports. This is one of the great, courageous young guys.
Right.
He inspired people all across the states, across Canada, around the world. Now with the Indian drums beating, you can feel the tension and excitement in the stadium.
Ken and Kathy, we do not believe, will be the last ones to carry the torch up the final 50 and then 20 more steps.
Yeah. Brendan. Corner it up.
Watch. Another torchbearer is about to appear. There she is. 12-year-old Robin Perry, a seventh grader from St. Bonaventure School in Calgary. She's been figure skating since the age of nine. She started up at Okotoks, the little village near here. She is going to light the flame, symbolizing youth. Remember the Barbara Ann Scott, representing the past, was the first torchbearer in St. John's, Newfoundland, Peter. And I think it's a great idea.
The next generation.
Having received the torch, Robin Perry, 12 years of age, a future Olympian. On a remis la flamme à la jeune Robin Perry, 12 ans, un futur espoir olympique.
Will she have something to tell the kids in school? Hope she can reach it.
Yes.
There it goes. Oh, boy. All the church bells of Calgary are ringing right now. Snowbird, the Royal Canadian Air Force team, are about to swoop over the stadium, streaming the colors of the Olympics. See the cloth banners, streamers coming up to form a teepee around the flames. Shot inside one of the planes. Hear the church bells. they're coming back for another pass. Here they come. Nine pilots in training planes. CT-114, about 250 miles an hour at 300 feet. So the flame has been lit during the ancient Grecian Olympic Games. A flame burned at the altar of Zeus, in whose honor the games were held in those days. Now it's just a tribute to
the
unity of the athletes of the world gathered in convocation for the 15th Olympic Winter Games.
Les sortilèges de Québec, les danseurs de la Rivière Rouge from Manitoba, and les bédors from St. Paul, Alberta.
Another of those moments of a lifetime. It's also cold down there, the temperature 18 degrees Fahrenheit, 18, with a stiff wind blowing.
In 1976, Denver voted no to the Olympic Winter Games, and they found refuge in Innsbruck, Austria. As is often the case, a home nation athlete was the hero. Franz Klammer cascaded down the mountain like a runaway freight train to win the downhill. Dorothy Hamill became another American gold medal winner in figure skating, and John Curry gave Great Britain its first gold medal in the men's competition.
And now in 1988, the big party continues in McMahon Stadium. It's square dancing, 960 strong, recruited from 24 square dance clubs in Calgary. They range in age from 12 to 80. And Peter, I got to insist, you got to give me a call here. Give me some.
Well, I first got to tell you, Jimmy, that square dancing is incredibly popular all across the United States, and I want to hear from every one of them. But you element, you etch, and you go to the left, and you dip for the dive, and you dig for the clam. Now, the inside over, outside under. I could go on for hours. Let's listen to them. They're
I wish you
better.
Would. That's terrific. What a party. To the other side, keep on moving then. Recycle, fear life, and come on, circulate. Queen of the face that fair square through. Three quarter down, find the corner. Do an element left in the corner. One to come back, one with a do side do all the way down to the promenade. Athletes begin to leave. We'll be back one more time at McMahon Stadium in Calgary after this break. Tonight we bring you live coverage of ice hockey, the United States against Austria in a key game for the hopeful American team. The Soviet Union, playing in the same group with the U.S., plays Norway, and we'll check in on that one too.
Winter Games have been brought to you by the all-new Eagle Premier from Jeep Eagle. You can expect the best. By Miller Brewing Company, sole sponsor of the U.S. Olympic Training Centers. By U.S. Sprint, official long-distance sponsor of the 1988 U.S. Olympic team. And by IBM, the bigger picture, the people, products, and resources of IBM. Has been a presentation of ABC Sports.
A promotional fee has been paid to ABC by American Airlines, a proud sponsor of the ABC telecast of the 1988 Winter Olympics.
MacGyver's Richard Dean Anderson on hockey.
It's got spontaneity and structure. It's an aggressive sport. Best structured game known to man. To this man, anyway.
Oh, yeah!
I'm in heaven. It's a little boy's dream come true.
MacGyver returns Monday, February 29th, following the Olympics.
Meyer believes in products made in the USA.
Made in the USA.
Meyer's proud of the people working hard in the USA.
Made in the USA.
You can count on Meyer every day.
For
challenging. They are monuments turned for a month into a playground for the athletes of the winter sports world. We're in Calgary, where the Canadian West begins. Calgary, scene of the 15th Olympic Winter Games. Hello, I'm Jim McKay, and what a day this has been. The winds of yesterday have subsided here in Calgary, and that means that the Olympic downhill, one of the most exciting and important events in any Olympics, was run today. You're going to see it tonight, but perhaps you know the result of it already. But maybe you don't, and if not, I'm not going to be the guy to spoil your fun tonight. So you'll be seeing it just as it happened up at Nikiska today. Now, out at the Olympic Saddle Dome right now, Team USA is preparing to take on Czechoslovakia. It's an extremely important game for both teams. The U.S. got off to a good start, but they must stay with Czechoslovakia, get a tie perhaps, in order to really be on track for a shot in the medal round. As for Czechoslovakia, they were beaten by West Germany on Saturday. They've got to make a comeback tonight, or it's disaster for them. Quite a night coming up.
Olympic Winter Games are brought to you by Team Xerox, world leader in document processing. We document the world. The people of Dow. The Bartles and James Premium Wine Cooler Company. And Mercury, the shape you want to be in.
Favorite Martian with that antenna that will send us this signal.
We can see a little bit of new snow falling, but that's not going to bother much. You can also see the steepness up here. It is so steep, it's been foot packed, it's been watered down, and it's so icy up here. You see it right down here. These turns are so important up at the top. That top part, after the Olympics, will never be raced again. They're going to take the lift on the top right down. You see those skis just chattering away.
And then a brief moment to rest.
Okay, now on the lower part, it's almost like it's another downhill. It's flat, but with a lot of rolls and a lot of bumps. We can see those hands coming up under the chin. The racers have been testing for months and months to get just the fastest pair of skis. They have about 30 or 40 pair to choose from. He breaks the tuck just to go over the bumps. He has to keep those knees and ankles really loose. Another bump. Right back into his tuck. We can see those knees popping up and down. Have to be loose there. Key is not to force yourself, to glide. Make sure you're loose and relaxed. Press on those little bumps and gain speed. Some are called gliders. They're better than others. And here's the finish coming up.
At McGill University in Montreal, Pavel missed his calculus midterm to show us those pictures. Peter Mueller has no such concerns. He is the current world champion, and he will start things off. Following him, everyone will chase his time. All this happens at Nikiska. After a 24-hour delay, the men's downhill brings the mountains alive.
Losing a lot of time. He doesn't turn as well as Zerbergen. He's going to have to kind of let those skis slide a little bit and not fight the turns. He was a little low right there, but he didn't fight it. He let him out. Now he stood right on his downhill ski. That was a good turn. Okay, now he's on the turbo road. This is the chance to rest for just a second.
Rocketing through the trees, you can hear the crowd, which is lining the course. They began climbing the mountain early this morning.
Peter Mueller grew up in Zurich. He's a city boy, not a mountain boy, but he's one of the strongest, best conditioned on the entire circuit.
He looks like a pretty good mountain boy right now.
Well, he leaned into the hill just a little bit. He got on his edges, but he's letting him go wide. That's good. He's letting that speed carry.
These are the times that everyone else will be chasing. 82 miles an hour.
It's a little bit slower than it has been in some of the training. He was hitting pretty close to 90. He has an unusual touch. See how he keeps his butt right on the back of his skis. He's good in that butt. It's unusual because sometimes you think you catch air, but he says, no, it makes me go fast. I like that speed on the tail of my skis.
So many times, Peter Mueller has been told that his downhill career is over, and then he comes back with one more win.
We can see what looks like dirt on the track. That's the endings of pine grass. That's so they'll have good visibility. Oh, he almost sat back right there. He's so strong, he held it off.
That's gate 37 of the 40 on the course. Two more to go. Finish line in sight.
Can you hear one click of the camera?
He's struggling down here a little bit. He got his tips up, too.
If training is any indication, that is a good time for Peter Mueller. 2 minutes, 14 hundredths of a second. Now a 21-year-old member of an up-and-coming French team, Christophe Play. Listen to the ice, maybe the breathing, the crowd, all part of his Olympic experience.
Unbelievable record. I think he'd trade all of those for a win.
Almost 2 miles away and 2 minutes away.
5, 4, 3.
One thing about Zurbriggen, he'll risk everything up here. That's what sets him apart. He really turns through these big ones. He's the only one that can really carve those skis through here. He knows he's going to have to ski well up here if he's going to beat Mueller. He doesn't have Mueller's weight for that extra speed on the bottom. He looked good up on the top.
How is he doing in comparison to Mueller? Here's an early check. He's right there with him.
But only by 5 hundredths of a second. It's that extra edge, that extra push that makes it for Zurbriggen. Oh, he cuts his hand right to the snow. I don't think he lost much time, though. It's so steep and icy up there. Not to fight these turns too much down here.
Zurbriggen has increased his lead. Look at the speed, 82.9.
This could be one of the great classic events of all time. Mueller at the bottom, Zurbriggen on the course. Now we're going to see how those skis are going to run.
14 gates to go.
He hopes he has a fast pair. He was concerned about breaking that other pair there earlier this week at training.
His lead is bigger still.
Oh, now he's really moving. It looks like he does have a fast pair of skis. Now, what a run Zurbriggen is having up here. You can see him sitting on the back of his skis, looking for extra speed. He was perfect off that bump. Absolutely perfect.
The lead is still his, but not as big. He can see the finish line from here.
But he is flying. This is going to be a close one.
Zurbriggen, who has had everything in his career except an Olympic medal, and now he has that.
He's got it. What a victory. What a victory. There's more to come, but I don't think anybody can beat Zurbriggen.
As defeat.
Peter, you have nothing to feel ashamed of. You turned in a great run. It took everything that Zurbriggen could muster to pull this one out.
Ah, but there still might be another challenge. The final skier in the elite group of 15, Frank Picard, 23 years old, is currently on the course, and here he is. From the village of Albertville in France, the site of the 1992 Olympic Winter Games. His first intermediate time in comparison to Zurbriggen's is close in medal contention for France.
Not that bad. You know, a lot of people say that Picard is going to be one of the great ones for the French team. He's been a little bit inconsistent, but he does turn particularly well. Al, can you imagine flying down a mountain like this with just a pair of skis on your feet? Most recreational skiers can't even imagine what this would be like. For you who have never skied before, this is not just like regular skiing.
Pikal still right there in third place and holding. But still, look at the difference between his run, which is so fluid and so beautiful to watch, and compare it to Zurbriggen and Mueller's. Across the line, and Frank Picard of France has captured, we believe, the bronze medal for France. You know, it's interesting, his mother named him after Frank Sinatra, and they will be singing in Albertville tonight, the first French bronze medal since 1968, and Keeley, and a hug meanwhile for Zurbriggen, he knows the gold is his. That is Monica Yulin, the cousin of Max Yulin, the Swiss skier who captured the gold in the GS in Sarajevo in 84. This is at the top of the mountain, a very important moment for Zurbriggen, Bob.
You can see him come right down through here, plants that hand right on the snow. Almost went down there. A great recovery. Then right off the ground. This is called skiing on the edge, I'll tell you. This is called going for that little bit of extra speed. Boy, I'll tell you, when you ski like this and you're that reckless, you must really want to win. And now he loses that ski. Look at that left ski slide out. He catches himself with his uphill ski, the right ski. Keeps it right on going, though. Great nerves, great racing nerves, great athletic ability.
His boot almost touching the ground there.
Amazing how he kind of pulls himself right through this turn. Particularly when you realize that he had to have a great run because Mueller was so good.
Going through an awful lot of soft snow there, Zurbriggen finally winning his Olympic gold medal. Let's go down to the finish line of Jack Edwards.
Pirman Zurbriggen, the gold medalist in the Olympic downhill. Pirman, before the Olympic Games, you said you would be happy with one medal of any kind, but wasn't it this medal in this race that you had in mind?
Yeah, perhaps I thought this was the beautiful synchron I can do with Kanaka Window. The downhill, but I was really nervous in the start.
Peter Mueller, your teammate, put up a great time. You knew about that at the start. What was going through your mind? What were you thinking about?
Yes, I saw the time and then I didn't know exactly if I can win because he skied so very well and he had risky fast. And so I thought, no, you must attack what you can and take all the limit.
You did attack. Your hand touched the snow, the upper part of the course, because you were so aggressive. Did you think that you might almost lose it?
Yeah, I lose. I think when you win, you can't look where you lose the time.
The men's downhill at these Calgary Olympic Winter Games. It was a story of a showdown between Zurbriggen and Mueller, only 51 hundredths of a second separating them. And then the flying Frenchman, Picard.
And here comes Peter Mueller over to shake hands. Now these are two great champions.
And Zurbriggen's quest for Olympic gold has only begun.
What a receptive crowd in the Saddle Dome tonight, giving all these pairs their just due.
You know, I think that was a very interestingly prepared performance. They took it extremely slowly. There was absolutely no intention of them to go out and hit it hard and run the risk of missing those jumps.
Here's the one they did miss.
Look at these side-by-side jumps, the mirroring the image. She landed the jump, fell out of it a little bit, put her hand down, sat down the rest of the way, and came on up. But with the sort of performance of the rest of the program, I think that that shouldn't mark off too much. They did a lot of good, difficult moves there.
All right. It appears that there's a silver and bronze medal at stake and three pairs battling for it. Yes, Dick?
Look at this. It was very, very pretty. Beautiful. Beautiful overhead as she went then into a flat, almost platter-like lift position. Really very nice. And interestingly enough, during that performance, a photographer or someone at the far end of the rink dropped a camera over onto the ice. One of the workmen, one of the ushers in the building, got out on the ice, went onto the ice, picked up the camera, and took it off. You can see it right there in the back of the picture. I must say,
I've never seen that in competition.
It just is an incredible situation. The fact that it did not take off from there,
point
of view.
Well, they were totally concentrating
really,
on what they had
really
to
something.
Do.
What a thing.
With a huge lens, too.
All right, let's stand by now for the marks. Throwing flowers is one thing, but cameras, come on. A little delay on the marks here. Here they come. Technical merit first. 5.4 to 5.7, the 5.4 from the British jump judge, who has been marking on the low side all evening. Of course, it only matters where that judge marks you in relation to where that judge marked everybody else. There's the cameraman who had the problem. Talk about embarrassed. All right, another set of marks to come now for our
interesting that Austria, Czechoslovakia, and Poland were quite high.
Well, they're happy. Look at this. 5.7, 5.8, 5.6 from Britain and Canada. 5.7 from Australia, Czechoslovakia, and 5.8 from East Germany and Poland. Very interesting set of marks. Let's go down to David again. David Santee.
Well, those marks certainly should ensure you of a medal. What do you think?
We are so excited to have a little slip in the opening and come back with the perfect routine. We're just so excited, and Jill did a tremendous job to come back.
As of now, you are in second place of all those who have skated.
Well, that's fantastic. We'll have to wait and see what happens now.
Congratulations.
Please, thank you.
Now, in second place, can they hold on to second place? Well, that depends on the performance of this pair, Yelena Volova and Oleg Vasilyev, the defending Olympic champions. She's been having a problem, remember, with her left ankle. This could be a very close.
14.5 meters. Listen to this crowd.
There's no question that he can beat it. It's just going to be difficult. Mentally, it's so tough to sit up there and know that you have to go past the critical point of the hill, rather past the point where the hill begins to flatten out. If anybody can do it, it's Maddie, but they've really, really backed him into a corner here. A little bit late. Looked like he hesitated right as he came into the air.
He keeps flying. He is remarkable. Matti Nykänen.
And again, Chris, that jump technically was not as good as some of Matti's best jumps.
118.5 meters.
That's a new hill record for Matti Nykänen. He's got the hill record on both hills now. Watch his left hand. He's hesitating there. He's trying to get a feel of how high he is and how far he's going to go. Now he sees he can gas it. He's getting on it, and he's going down, down, 118.5 meters. Beautiful jump.
Old record.
You, this guy is a champion.
Old record, 115.5. He beat it by three.
And I'll tell you, that left hand is really his rudder. That's what he works. He works to get over his skis a little bit more. Right on. You can see how flat the ground is right there. That's so hard. That's like jumping out of a four-story building onto ground that just is flat.
Former world junior champion and the Canadians here now in this crowd estimated at over 100,000. Horst Bulow, 25 years old.
What a job he has following Matti Nykänen. Horst really has been spearheading this Canadian effort that has seemed to stagnate a little bit in the last few years. He's on his skis. Very nice jump. Great jump for Horst Bulow. The Canadians erupt. Boy, I didn't think he was going to be able to do that. He hasn't been good in training on the 70 meter. He finished 44th.
112.5 meters.
Very clean, very clean. You saw the arms were quiet, the upper body low. That's just what you want to do. Here, anybody can do that, or any of these guys out here can do that. The flying part, that's the fun part. Landed it right down there. He's in sixth place, but not far out of the medals as far as points.
Yes. Horst Bulow, 109.4 points, standing sixth.
You know, that's a nice place to be, Chris, because he's close to the medals, but nothing is expected. If he doesn't finish in them, heck, he was never there. He can move up, though, with just another good jump.
And he did it after a hill record fly-in by Matti Nykänen. We all wonder how big these towers are and how far the jumpers fly.
If you've ever wondered what it's like to ski this big 90-meter Olympic ski jumping hill, picture this. Start at the top row of the Rose Bowl, ski down the whole length of the bleachers, then jump clear to the other side over 100 yards away. That's Olympic 90-meter ski jumping for you.
Erik Jensen of Norway, 22 years old, and his very first training jump on this huge 90-meter hill, he hit 116 meters, Jeff.
And I'll tell you, Chris, he hasn't been around. Look at that shot. Boy, you can see what he's looking at. Oof. Big task at hand. He hasn't done much in World Cup competition. In fact, he's sort of an up-and-comer. At 22 years of age, you would think that would be odd, since there are many younger ski jumpers. Holy smokes, he really hit that. Whoa! Oh, gee! Is that a hand that touched? I saw the snow fly. Well, it'll be interesting to see what the judges do on that. Long jump, though. The Norwegians have such a history of not being able to do it in the big tournaments. Looking at it again. Very low with the upper body, that's the key. Nice, nice extension there. Flying like a bird. Let's see what hit here. Beautiful tone. Whoa, his knee touched the snow.
Did the judges see that?
You know,
look how far he went, 114.5.
Apparently the judges didn't see that. Look at that, second place.
113.7 on a calm day. And after the first round of jumps on the 90-meter hill individual competition, as expected, Matti Nykänen is in the lead. Janssen of Norway is second, Plotch of Czechoslovakia third, Klauser of West Germany, Felder of Austria. For the United States, Mike Holland in 25th. For Canada, Horst Bulow in 7th.
Another bit of Olympic history from Matti Nykänen. And look at this, the ice dancing coming up next as we continue our Olympic coverage after this ABC News brief and a word from your local station.
Winter Games, brought to you by Lennox Heating and Air Conditioning. Lennox, quality proven over time. Merrill Lynch, an investment firm built on a tradition of trust. And Chrysler, we're driving to be the best.
So already we've seen two bits of Olympic history tonight. We have seen a world record in women's speed skating, and that jump of Matti Nykänen's, the first of two. We'll be seeing the other jumps a little bit later on tonight's program. Matti Nykänen's jump has now been established as the longest ski jump in the history of the Winter Olympics. We're going to move now, though, to the subject of ice dancing and a couple called Torvill and Dean. People wonder if there could ever be a dance couple as great as them, Torvill and Dean of Great Britain, who dazzled the Olympic world 4 years ago. Some think we may see their equals tonight in Bestyanova and Bukin of the Soviet Union. So let's set up a comparison. Here they are. First of all, they're doing commentary for Australian television, and we'll be talking with them in just a couple of minutes. But right now, why don't we take a look at their historic performance set to the music of Ravel's Bolero at Sarajevo in 1984. Remember?
So difficult to do, and a lot of their moves are created by Christopher Dean. He helps in all the choreography, and everything they do is original, and it's very different and very interpretive to the music.
steady progression of moves, each one different and progressing further with each step and beat of the music.
Beautiful performance that was perhaps not difficult, perhaps no changes, perhaps nothing. You can criticize it from here to zero, from here to the end of the week. But it was a beautiful emotional experience, and that's what all that counts about this game. Wonderful.
Per usual, we've become accustomed to sixes, and there are three of them, and the rest are 5.9. All perfect marks.
Oh, we are so lucky to be here to see this. This is wonderful.
That really does seem just like yesterday. In a minute, we'll be talking to them live from the Saddle Dome in Calgary. Competition will begin very shortly.
I'm in you, and I think to myself, what a wonderful world.
When Robin Perry ignited the Olympic torch, she began a 16-day party Western Canada will long remember and which the International Olympic Committee may look back on as a benchmark. These games solidified what the Los Angeles Olympics had launched so successfully, the use of corporate sponsorship and a realistic approach to the amateur-professional relationship, which had been a hypocritical albatross around the Olympics' neck during the Brundage years. These were the games where the Eastern Bloc countries seemed more relaxed and friendly, smiling and showing emotion as readily as their Western competitors. They revealed very attractive personalities that for so long seemed frozen behind stern visages, frowns, and sullen looks. Here in Calgary, they were positively beaming. These were the games where Eddie Edwards made ski jumping an English export to rival gin and tweeds. This James Joyce look-alike, whose one small leap for mankind swept the crowd along on an emotional wave, made us all think seriously that winning medals is not everything. And these were the games that moved another winter sport indoors. Speed skating, which had been born on the frozen lakes of Scandinavia and nurtured on the canals of Holland, was held in the magnificent Olympic Oval, fundamentally changing the sport. Inside the oval, there was no wind or cold or snow or bumps. The skaters slid by on ice as smooth as plastic, and many new records were established. Established, not broken. The old record set outdoors should still stand in the wind and the snow and the cold. Finally, these were the warm weather winter games, as a combination of the Chinook winds and El Nino sent the thermometer higher than a Matti Nuukkonen ski jump. The result was a brown look around Calgary that would have been depressing, had it not been for the great high spirits of our hosts, the Calgarians. They threw a marvelous party, and we all had a real good time.
A good time, yes, and we've also collected once again a wealth of memories from these games, and still more to come. We'll be going to the Saddle Dome for an exhibition of figure skating featuring Olympic medalists from here in Calgary, and then all the color and festivities of the closing ceremony. By the way, Bonnie Blair, who won a gold and bronze medal in speed skating, will carry the flag for the U.S. team. It's all coming up, so stay with us.
The flags of all the 57 nations that have participated in these games, led, of course, as is traditional by Greece, which still has not won a Winter Olympics medal. The skaters carrying the flag.